shared with me all of the data from 2007.
The finance committee is at 3 o'clock today. Is everybody going back there?
No, we have a meeting in there until 3 o'clock, so we'll see.
I'm good. As long as I'm not late.
To do the study for stormwater. But, you know, understanding better what Gwinnett's done, and I don't know whether they're up to speed with what Gwinnett's done.
Hey, how are you?
Hey, you want to go back? We'll go back and see that 2 o'clock meeting is over.
Okay.
Let me know. This is Carla. I got you. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
Are we still waiting?
The last I checked, we were.
I didn't bring them up.
Excellent. A minute?
A minute, okay. All right.
Winding it up. Pat coming today here?
She is. She wasn't here.
She might be back there already. I don't know. I remember last time.
She said she's going to stand outside the door.
Wait for people to come out.
I remember she wanted detailed notes, like kind of notes from last one. I'm like, I don't really have a lot of notes. I'm really just the number guy. Tell me the number that would be the budget.
Right.
That's right.
Yeah, she is. She'll be there. She does have to leave at 4. She's got to enter by telephone interview. She has to be in on. So we're supposed to sit on track and have a decision.
I'm going to like 10 minutes.
So, okay. So if it gets to be 3:50 and I start crying,
I'm like 10 minutes. I'm out. Okay. You better stay out. That's why I brought the same presentation with 4 additional pages. That's all we got to look at. 4 additional pages.
4 additional pages.
Super fast. I'm like, I'll do the whole thing. Go over the pages.
I'm going to drive for 10 minutes now.
That is to fix the pagination last time.
I can do that.
Do you want Nydia?
You can pull your plan.
The commissioner?
Want this up here?
Are you?
Because that's where, okay.
By the time I got to him, like, oh, meeting's been set, I got.
You're dragging.
There you go.
Thank you.
Thank you. Earl, I just didn't get a chance to get back to the talk.
There's, there'll be more.
Okay.
There's more than enough to get around.
Three of five, right?
Is there five of them?
Yeah.
All of that.
Oh, right, we can always, I guess, use it on the next.
Who said that?
It's on tape, I'm sure, so. Film it doesn't work.
What about that? You should hang this, frame this for your office.
Frame it for our office.
There is more information on there than you care to know what to do with. It had to do with that.
Okay.
It's on both sides.
Let's go ahead and open.
I'm really impressed.
Let's go ahead and open the meeting, call meeting, meeting order. We do have a quorum. First item on the agenda is adoption of the agenda. Is that in front of you? Motion to adopt the agenda. Motion. And a second. Motion, a second, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed or being none, that passes. Adoption of the minutes, this is for the adoption of the minutes of the call meeting of July 17th, 2014. Let the record reflect that Chairman Amos has entered the room. This is for, again, the adoption of the minutes for the called meeting of July 17th, 2014.
Make a motion that we adopt the minutes as presented.
Motion is there a second?
Second.
Motion is second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, being none, that passes. Item four is items to be discussed. This is review Northwestern benefits for FY 2015 budget. Pat, are you, who's starting?
Commissioners and committee, this is a follow-up to the previous finance committee meeting, and in which Mr. Dan Beard from Northwestern Benefits, who is our benefits consultant, did present some preliminary information for the 2015 employee benefit program. At that meeting, he was asked to bring back further detailed information, specifically from other county governments, and also additional information regarding the narrowing down of the, for the life AD&D short-term, long-term disability vendors. Dan, would you like to proceed?
Sure. So, this should look familiar to you. This is the basic same presentation I had before, but since I was just asked for some additional information, I just updated and added a few slides. I didn't really intend on going through all 23 pages unless you want me to hit anything from before. I just thought I would actually.
You did such a great job of organizing. It's still there.
It's just still there.
It's like a
week. It hadn't permeated yet, but it's still there.
It's still there.
So what I thought I would do is just tell you the things I had changed. There's only one major slide in the body of the presentation, and I added a few things that you asked. So the main piece that I added was on page 7. Everything before that was the same. Since the last meeting, we did get back the best and final, and the benefits committee that I work with made a recommendation. The staff committee that are here made a recommendation to take the short-term, long-term life AD&D from Interim. And move it to Aetna. It's a better overall deal for the county. We were at the end of a 3-year rate guarantee, so that's why it went to market. And Unum came back with a 5.5% increase over the current rates, and they were
Gruen to lock in those rates for 2 years, and they came back with the 2.14% over current, as well as locking in for 3 years and adding another $16,000 that will come off your medical premiums since you had your venture medical through. So as far as an overall value, we did the one-to-one comparison too, and the claims are the same. So the staff committee recommended, and I agree, and we're recommending that, that they move those products. It actually will have another, with the major medical moving from Coventry to Aetna and then having your disability and your own pieces, the continuity between the two is an added bonus to that too. So this is an all-around good move, not only financially, but should be for the people on the plane as well.
Do you have the page with the dollar amounts on you so they don't have to do what, 2%? How much money we're talking about?
I have that in here.
I think he's given this to me.
Yeah.
We did work on that on the community.
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember, actually, so it's
amounts
like $20,000
to $30,000. It is. It, oh, well, the difference is it's a little over 16 for the difference, 2%, and then another 16 for adding. It's 32,000 total difference between the game and that a year. I didn't add that.
And it's up to 32,000 less, but.
Correct. Then staying with me.
Daniel, when you do that comparison, I'm sure you did this, but you also factored in the buy-up that the employees have an option for as well.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's all. That's all included. Thank you.
Okay.
That's in my car.
Because we're talking, you know, we're talking about taking the 2%. We're talking about $500,000 worth of coverage between the basic life, long-term disability, core buy-up, and the short-term disability. These three lines.
That's right. Correct.
Okay.
And so it comes in at. On this one, this is the 513,000. Yeah, there's the 16,000 roughly.
Right.
Unum is 532,000, so there's the 16,000 change. Plus, we get it's like a multi-line discount you on the insurance. Plus, they get a 16,000 off on our health care. So that was once we got the coverages identical to each other, make sure they were all funded the same coverages. That's where we're at, and the committee took a poll on ourselves. So that was kind of a recommendation from this committee. Okay,
well
that's right.
Yes. So it's not always about money, of course. We want the coverage to be the same. And again, having it go from Unum to Aetna. Unum is a great company, and Aetna is as well. So, but there is an added bonus to having a major medical carrier and your ancillary carrier to the same carrier.
Okay. So. We were also able to leverage this to have a PTSD coverage in the disability for all county employees. We had just had a carve out with Unum for the public safety. Now this goes back to when we, before we changed to Unum, it was covered for all county employees. So that's maybe a minor thing, but I think it's very important that we have that available for all of the employees for disability.
Anything else that you could think of?
I wasn't the only one that called on this, was I?
No, we were all late, sir.
We've been here since you
finished. Everyone else was late.
Oh, Mabel was here. I don't
know how much good to say. Thank you. So
how does
get your meal for Carol, too?
Yeah.
We're not there yet.
Okay.
We're getting
okay.
There. Well, that's kind of next on my agenda.
Okay.
As far as I wanted, again, the major change from the presentation before. We had already recommended that the stop loss stay with Aetna. We got a reduction in fees on that. So that was one of the motion or recommendation I made before. This was the only decision that was new since I stopped last time.
32.
And just let the record reflect that Commissioner Tan is here at 3:15.
You have to say that?
Yes, sir.
There was one of the other questions that you had was in regards to premium cost share for the employees.
Right.
actually for a...
Are we doing that first item before?
We are going to get a...
Can we go ahead and get a recommendation on this?
Yeah.
Sure.
I like the recommendation we go with, and that's what you need, Dave?
For the short-term Misty, long-term Misty, and ED?
Yes, sir.
Second.
It's a recommendation of the full board.
Sure.
For award.
Yes, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, there being none, that passes, we recommend to the board commissioner.
All right, next.
Well, I'm sorry to jump ahead. There were a couple, at the very back of the presentation, slides 21, 22, and 23. Again, these are the new slides. Everything else is the same, but these are additional items that you guys wanted to discuss specifically.
Well, I think that then we,
Well, that leads into this.
Okay.
That's here, too.
Okay.
Yeah, that's actually here.
Okay.
So there are three pieces that we had discussed that we want to follow up on. I actually haven't quite out of order. One was the out-of-pocket maximum. We made a recommendation to increase the out-of-pocket maximum as far as the plan goes, and we wanted to know what other out-of-pocket maximums look like with comparative data.
We're up to 22 now.
Yeah.
Well, we'll go back. I should have put 22 or 29.
Right.
So I went in, and actually this, the very, very large chart has comparative data across lines. I'm not asking you to look at it. It's a backup, kind of. Really, I isolated the out-of-pocket maximums off that sheet and put it here for you to see on 22. And as far as ACA has mandates that limit the amount of out-of-pocket maximums you can put, that is only on your in-network benefits. Your out-of-network benefits, you can have it unlimited if you care to, and there are actually some counties that go that direction. So before we go into that, I wanted you to know that you can have, as far as I have this broken down into in-network and out-of-network, so you can see how you compare. And out-of-network, you can see, it's like Clayton County has unlimited across there, so you can do that if you so choose. That being said, for your in-network on your core plan, Forsyth is basically right in the middle on your out-of-pocket maximums. You're lower than some and higher than others, and you're literally the median, right in the center, I would say, between across all your comparative data. And then your in-network, for the buy-up plan, you're lower than everyone as far as your out-of-pocket maximums go. You're the absolute lowest across other competitors. So, we wanted to look at that in terms of whether you would want to or not want to raise your out-of-pocket maximum. Again, that recommendation was given because your plan has changed due to your ACA mandates. All copays at one time, no copay applies towards your out-of-pocket maximum. Now all copays apply to your out-of-pocket maximum. So if you were to get high medications, a lot of high medication usage, person can hit their out-of-pocket maximum very quickly. So it's probably somewhere between 1-2% added claim spend. If you want to account for that, as opposed to the county taking that all on. So a typical, or where our standard amounts across our book of business has been between $500 and $1,000 on the out-of-pocket maximum to help absorb that new mandate. It went into effect last year. Coventry put that in on their book of business, and the county didn't make any changes. In fact, to the county's defense, they didn't know before Coventry did it. So what I'm proposing now is that you change the plan to help mitigate that for going forwards, because it's a permanent change to Coventry's stay.
Why didn't we know?
Well, go ahead.
Interesting. Part of it was the health care reform. We weren't even advised as an employer until about the end of November. And then Coventry actually had the option whether to put it on their employee or their clients for this year or table it for next year. And they had already made that decision to pass along to us when we were in the final, which was in December, that we weren't advised.
We were already had gone past open enrollment.
Books have been printed every
It was way too late.
Too late.
Yeah.
That predates me by a couple months, but I knew that. I knew that it just, they just hadn't said that. They did it across all lines of their business, but didn't really do a very good job of setting. I mean, they've done a great job of managing claims, but they apparently didn't do a very good job of making that known. So it wasn't specific to Forsyth, but it was actually done across all their books of business. Nobody knew that. So again, I didn't make a specific recommendation because I knew you want to take a look at what others were doing. And again, on the core plan, you're right in the middle, both on the single and the family. And on the buy-up plan, you're again lowest on single and family as far as out of max goes. So there's room there if you're looking for a benchmark. And you don't necessarily have to take the recommendation at all. I'm trying to give you the best information to gauge. My recommendation would be a minimum of 500 on the single and the family, but
you mean an increase?
An increase of out of
pocket. Out of pocket. For the network, in network, and out of network? Across the park, just out?
Your out of network benefit looks to be set up well enough. I wouldn't. You could make it.
So, but just in network then?
I wouldn't. The in network benefit. It's the one that's off. It's not off. By all means, I'm not saying anything's been done wrong, but out of network, I don't see a real need to change it, but definitely in network.
I want to make sure I understand. And the in network, we're at 3,000 and 1,000, but just take the buy-up plan at 1,000. When you compare us to, for instance, Barrow, we're comparing, it's a difference of $1,000. I'm reading that correctly.
Right.
And then
that's
across
correct.
The board, it looks like several of them are 2,000. 2,000 and then 1,800. And
correct.
what your recommendation is to go up to 15 or increase by 15?
No.
Go
up,
to 2,500 to 1,500.
Correct.
To 35 and 15.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. And the family.
You mean on the core?
On the core plan.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And did family also too?
Correct.
65 and 25.
Well, the family, there's more room to move. I would say a minimum of $500 additional on both plans. On the family, you could go as high as 1,000 because you're off again, even more significant compared to.
The family's basically double the single. So
correct. The family's basically double the single.
So you have 1,335.
Correct. That's why.
Because 7,3.
I would recommend on the buy-up to 1,500 on the single and 3,000 on the family. The core, you're.
And that means our out-of-pocket expense per employee will be increased.
It means that the employees will take on more of the expense before it hits. Once your out-of-pocket's met, the county pays for every bill that that employee has.
Well, basically it means they have to pay $500 more out-of-pocket.
Right.
That's correct.
And for the family, it's going to
be $1,000.
It may not be an increase to people compared to now. Because right now, when we pay our prescription and our doctor's office co-pays, we pay them no matter what. If we ever hit our out-of-pocket, not figured, we always pay that. At a $1,000 level, a person could have enough prescription co-pays and doctor's visits where they'll hit that $1,000. And from then on, they're not going to pay any copay for the prescriptions, for the doctors. And in other words, they'll have more benefits than they have now.
Yeah, you not prescriptions.
By raising 500, the chances they won't hit that, probably, and they'll still pay what they're paying now. The one it would impact is for those that have a big hospital visit, and it's going to, they're going to have a 20% whatever they pay, and they might have hit the 1,000, then they would hit the 1,500. But those are large claims, and that $500 should not impact as much as.
But it's going to impact someone that doesn't have the drugs or doctor visits like some the younger people.
Yeah.
The older people that have the drugs and doctor visits, they're going to use their copay up quicker.
Correct. Under this, they end up paying less.
Yeah.
The laws change.
But then when the young person goes and he says, okay, you owe $1,500, your total bill is $2,000, and you owe us $1,500, and the insurance going to pay $500. So basically, we hit them for $500.
Yeah,
and if I have a major medical one time.
It takes a lot to get there. We're under, this plan, what, 80-20?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so they're still deductible after the 500. So to end up paying, say, $1,000, you'd have to have a claim of how much is it, 80-20?
You'd have a copay, 500.
About 5,000. 5,000, 2,000 is 20% of 5,000. Mm-hmm. So they have a $5,000 bill. Mm-hmm. Our 20% responsibility after deductible is you pay $1,000.
Yeah.
So it would have to be a bill above $5,000 right now, if there's no way, for you to, under 1500, pay more than $1,000.
Well,
it'd be a large bill.
Yeah. Well, not really. If you go to the doctor, it's not hard to get over $5,000.
Well,
it's a major.
I'm thinking $5,000 is a large bill. But yeah, you're right, for medical.
Yeah, it'd be one day in hospital.
But that's what it would take to get there. It means that.
Well, the difference and the main thing for this is it used to be regardless, your co-pays continued even when you hit your out-of-pocket max.
Yeah.
So if you had a large, if you were on a very expensive medication, you would continue to pay that co-pay for the rest of the year forever.
That's right. That's
what difference. Happens now is that co-pay goes away. And there's certain drugs, specifically like tier 3 drugs, and I can't give you the names and prices, but they're very expensive. Some of them are $10,000 a month. The co-pay off of that alone would hit your out-of-pocket maximum after less than a month.
But that's what we really need to advertise to our employees. It may sound like we're going up on co-pay $1,500, but basically the people that are getting the medicine and the co-pays now, it's going to use that co-pay up.
That's correct. The ones that are using it are the ones that it'll affect. And ultimately, even though you're getting $500 or $1,000 more from them, the ones that really need it, it will stop, and then they won't have to pay their co-pays. And it's a rarity. You don't have a lot of people on tier 3 medications paying $10,000, but the ones that are. So this is one of those changes that's really there to protect you from high dollar claimants. And really, once they get that high, it's helpful that you're at least giving a little bit of the money back. But this is very common as far as just helping to mitigate the cost, but it's not going to affect a large part of the population. You're heavy users.
Does this start to affect us and get us out of the Cadillac plan? Or we still?
Sure. This is one step that actually mitigates a little bit of your, one of the ways that you get away from your Cadillac taxes by pushing more responsibility to employees. This is one step. This is one way that would happen. Yes. It's very true.
But even at $1,500, if you have enough claims that they hit that $1,500, it's still going to stop, and they're not going to pay any more co-pays or doctors.
Right,
it's still a true cap. The most anyone would pay would be $1,500 under the new law. Before you kept paying co-pays no matter what.
Correct. And so it is going to add, what's happened is last year, again, I don't have it specific for you because we're still only halfway through the year. And even then, I'm not sure we could isolate this to that level, but our average is 1.5 to 2% of your total claim spending. Your total claim spending is 6 million.
For all the health, close to 10 million.
So if you think about that, that one out of pocket, the fact that co-pays end adds 2% to your claims, you have $10 million. So you're not going to make that back up by putting these $500 and $1,000, but it will help. So you're spreading it out amongst the people that are actually using it. But you're not going to recapture all that. You're going to absorb some of that. Now, with what Coventry's done from the county with the heavy management of claims, I had said, and just to recap last time, you're a million. Why, you guys came in $1 million less than your projected claims last year. And you're on target right now. You're not quite there, but you're close. You're at 6% under, which is about a little over $400,000, just under $500,000 under projected. So when we, each year, when the county is setting your rates for your employees, you take basically how much you project your claims are going to be, and then how much the employee, and then your fixed costs. This is what we went through before. Your fixed costs, which is what it costs for Aetna and Unum to administer your claims. You add all that together and divide that out by your total number of employees, and that's how we get the premiums, and which is one more thing that we'll talk about today. So,
how does it work on the fixed premium? You say we have $1 million short of our expected claims. Does the county get to keep that, or it rolls back into our budget?
It does. Now, we're projecting, of course, because we're basing it off of current claims. So we thought you were going to spend more than you did. So yes, that $1 million was built into your budget. It was never spent. Like, it never went out the door. You were budgeting for that.
and you set your budget again this year based off of a projection, and you're running under that one too. I've never had a client that's actually done that 2 years in a row. It's a great problem to have, but each year you've run better.
Hey, did we set aside that one or something? Raise that or not? Did you just go back to general fund?
General fund and savings last year, over $1 million, and their claims came in lower. We all charge the departments the actual claims. So we say it's part of how much the general fund had at the end of the year.
And the reason I bring that up, one of the other things we discussed that is in my notes here, which is on the next page.
Well,
and I know I jumped ahead, yeah. But I think it's related to you at the same time, just so you can see before they decide on that. I would at least like to see. The next slide is about the rates we had actually as far as. And again, this is isolated off this great big chart. I just gave you the big, great big chart so you can see what other people are doing. Your other question in regards to employee premiums, and this also goes hand in hand with the out-of-pocket maximum and how much the employee pay, was we made the recommendation not to change premium amounts, employee contributions, based off the fact that one, we were $1 million less than projected last year. Two, we're running $1 million or $500,000 under expected this year. And three, the renewals that just came back, your stop loss premium went down by 0.5%. So there's not a whole lot of reason to shift cost of employees as far as their premiums go. So in that regards of putting an extra little bit on the out-of-pocket maximum, we're not raising premiums, or at least I'm not expecting to raise premiums. And then raising this out-of-pocket maximum amount isn't going to affect hardly any of your population. So it's another reason to consider putting that on there, because your standard employee's not going to feel, your average employee isn't going to feel anything this year, except if we don't raise premiums, happy that they didn't have to pay more.
That's okay.
So what I wanted, I had a slide earlier that showed the percent, and it showed, hold on, you don't need to flip, I'll let me flip. So it showed the total cost to the county when the employees were paying 12%, the county's paying 88%. That was across all, this is isolated. There's so many different tiers that you have, that was a combination. So what I wanted to do was isolate, you wanted to see what is the standard percentage other employees pay. So I couldn't get Barrow and Hall per se as far as the percentage, because I needed the total cost, like what the total cost was. We could get, and you can see, what their employees pay on this major big chart. But unless I know what the total cost is to the county, I can't give you a percentage that they pay. We didn't have that available. I was able to get that for the city of Atlanta, Cobb County, DeKalb County, Fulton County, and Gwinnett County. So you can see some major counties, not ones that border you, but some fairly major counties in North Georgia, at least to get a benchmark off of. And that being said, you can see on page 23, again, Forsyth has it set up so you have tobacco rates, non-tobacco rates, wellness rates, and non-wellness rates, wellness rates, non-tobacco rates. There's 8 different breakouts. So I had to just choose one that best closely fit what the other counties have. Most counties don't. Either they have a tobacco rate or they have a wellness rate. They don't tend to have a tobacco and wellness rate. Or they don't have anything but one rate, and you don't, it doesn't matter whether you smoke or you don't smoke or you use tobacco. So again, I had to kind of cross section this just to give you any kind of comparative data. So I chose for the county, Forsyth, the core plan and the premium plan, not tobacco users, not the wellness rate, but just a standard non-tobacco rate, because there were others.
The majority of the employees are on non-tobacco users.
Right.
I mean,
so I thought that would be as close as I could cut it across. So the city of Atlanta doesn't offer a tobacco rate or a wellness rate, but you can see that their employees pay 30% of the cost. Clayton County, you can see there's a split between employee and family, and then they have 2 different plans. Say they have a standard plan and a buy-up plan. Lifestyles plan, which is probably kind of a wellness. I don't know what lifestyles, I can only assume that may have been a more of a wellness style plan, but their standard plan, their employees are paying 30%, DeKalb County, Fulton County, 27%. Forsyth is at 16-17%. So you're 10% lower across the board. And then on the family plan, you're even lower than that. So you're, the point of this slide is to show that you're treating employees as far as their share of the costs. It's great. They have a very expensive plan, and they're paying a very small portion of it.
Now, when we did the salary studies,
the compensation study,
this will play into it.
Yes, they will be looking at the full benefits, not only just medical, dental, but all of the
We should, in that study, it should be reflective of exactly what he's telling us in that end of it.
Yes.
I believe that's exactly what you said.
Correct.
It won't get necessarily down into the finest detail, like recommending that we move employee benefits.
No, but it will count toward what they're earning. I mean,
absolutely.
What he's saying should mean
total compensation.
Total compensation.
And it should be a positive. That should be a really good thing.
It's a no. Yes.
Our employees.
Mm-hmm. And most employees don't. I mean, no one's fault. Most employees don't know how good their plan is because they don't have this. Frameless, by the way, so this is a nice question.
It's
very
so
colorful.
It is.
And there are more. And there are more rates on the. There are more rates on the back too, so you can see
the back.
How you compare it.
But across,
well,
if
high you quality look, paper too.
I don't mess around.
It's photo paper.
I like that.
I was thinking we were paying out a lot if we got this.
Yeah. No extra charge.
No extra charge. And the same on your tobacco free rates. Again, I use essentially the same. You can see that there were actually true tobacco free rates with a cop count. And you can compare those side by side. And in that, your rates on employee only, I should say, they're pretty comparable. And the family, they're still getting a good deal. So this is a telling story in another piece, my third slide that's in here. But you can see that your family rates are cheaper than anybody else by a great huge considerable amount, which lends itself to one final slide, and this all ties in together. If you go back to slide 21, which is the first one kind of that I added, you can see here that your claims payment distribution, we wanted to bring it out so you could see what effect this has on having such a great plan for spouses and families, that your spouses account for 42% of your total claim spend. Total. Now, subscribers and dependents have to be on the plan. You have to offer coverage to dependents. It's a mandate. Now, I'm not saying that you should exclude spouses. Saying that you have a spousal surcharge, you can see there are 197 spouses that have part. Someone's paying for 197 spouses
to
be under plan. But you can see what that, the cause of, I mean, the effect of that. So I keep all these three slides together so you can see a whole picture, right? Your contributions by family are 8% of total costs for that family. And you can see here that that's lending directly to the fact that you're having more spouses on your plan.
We currently have a surcharge. It's $25 a pay period, which is $650 a year to have your spouse on there.
For those that can have it with an employer elsewhere.
Yes.
Not for those that are non-working
yes.
spouses.
Individuals that have spouses that do not have availability of coverage with another employer or not employed, they do not pay the surcharge.
So these 97 are choosing to pay about $600 a year roughly to be on our plan, which tells you something about how good our plan is. When they
but
go
is
elsewhere
that
coverage.
Should we charge more than that?
Yeah, I don't know how many migrated when we initially did that. We hit, what, 200 and so? A few migrated, but not a lot, I don't think.
Yeah, not many migrated, it's really not that much, but the long-term implications go back to the Cadillac plan problems, and as you saw on page 17 in there, that is very looming, and we're not going to cut it and really reach that by just making some minor adjustments to the plan itself, so different things need to be considered and looked at.
Right.
And one of the considerations would be to increase that spouse's surcharge.
So Obamacare has caused...
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, a lot of this stuff.
Major expenses.
Yes.
And they penalize you for having a good plan.
Basically.
Yeah.
Too good plan, yeah, if you have a good plan.
If you have two, if you offer too good of a plan, you get...
Well, this is, the Cadillac tax is really set in place to have plans that are very rich pay for individuals and other plans are not. Right, because one of the things that happened with the ACA mandate is the fact that no one can get turned down for insurance anymore. So anybody that was uninsurable before can now be insured, and they have to get allowed a plan. Whether it's expensive or not, that's a whole different matter. So all the ACA mandate, all the different penalties, the reinsurance fees, and all these other fees that are being paid for right now go away in 2018, and then the Cadillac tax comes on. 2018. So one stops, another starts. Well, this is another way of continuing to generate money to pay for all the people that were uninsured to continue to fund the keep.
So if we don't make adjustments to our plan, the tax is going to be...
It could. It can. These are projections, and these are literally projections as it stands now.
But it could get changed.
It very well could be. If the administration changes, and
it could be a way of much just projected change.
Correct. So we can only model and predict what we know right now. If there's administration change, if the Republicans take it and they come in and start slashing out some of the ACA mandate, you know, pieces, it's hard to say. Knowing what we know right now, these are your projections as what will happen, all things staying equal. Now this took into consideration that every year your costs, your claims costs are gonna go up and your costs are gonna go up 8%. This past year it didn't. Last year you went down. And do I expect that to continue? I would love to say that it will, but I don't think it will. Because naturally, inflation is going to happen, doctor's charges are going to go up. So it's going to go up naturally because of inflation and the cost of services are going to go up. But we're holding it as tight as we can. So this is based on 8%. If your claims only go up 3%, well then this whole model changes and it goes down by 5% per year. That's something we can't predict. We can only give you, here's what it looks like right now. But there are, again, page 18, there are only two ways to minimize the impact. I know we're kind of jumping around, but I'll tie this up in one big thing for you in a second. There's only one way to minimize, or a couple ways, there's only so many levers to impact the Cadillac tax. One is your claims costs, right? So the higher your claims costs, and that's cost per employee. So you take your entire cost divided by total members on the plan, and the government says that it should only cost this much to insure a person, and the county is costing this much, so you pay the difference, right? So you lower your claims costs, and you get it below what they say it should cost to insure a person, and you don't have a tax, right? And the other is to reduce your population.
So just fire everybody?
No. There are things such as...
That's one way.
Well, that's true.
You can't fire people. I'm not saying that.
Whatever.
Say that.
Is Nydia on our...
I think that's one extreme.
Well, extreme. But again, you have to consider as we move closer and depending on what happens, you know, this year maybe not, next year maybe not, but as the Cadillac tax starts to loom and you know where your costs are coming from, you can half your Cadillac tax responsibility by, I'm not saying you should do this, I'm saying this is an idea, a way of doing it. You can cut off this entire middle column, 42% of your costs can go away.
The part can go to other countries. Well, I'm sure we can
cut them all out.
But not allowing spouses.
You can not allow spouses, and that is legal to do. I'm not saying you would. I'm saying that is a drastic measure to handle the Cadillac tax. Or instead of offering a spousal surcharge, you can just, anyone that has coverage in other plans are forced to go to those plans. Well, I don't know the percentage, but more than 30%, I would say, of my plans already have it set up. So if you have coverage elsewhere, you can't be on that plan.
So you've got 192 families or 92 people that are paying the penalty to have their spouse on. I don't know what, you know, I can't think what that, what would happen, but I'm saying you could exit spouse, you could put spouses off that have coverage elsewhere.
Or
but that's not, charge. That's not, we could get by, like I said, for a couple of years, at some way in 2018.
That would be a major, if you were to push off spouses, or even spouses with other coverage you're talking about, it could be a potentially big change. I know I can't predict what that is right now, but if you were to push spouses off altogether, then your claims costs are...
Yeah, but if we could push this off to 2017, 18, so, I mean,
well,
you don't
we,
have to do it
now.
Do it
no, you don't have to do it now. I'm just giving you foresight of what needs to happen. You're either going to make plan changes and change cost shift to the employees, or you're going to lower your claims costs by either one, getting your population healthy, which is healthier people, lower claims, that's what we hope for. And that's being worked on now. But that's it. Those are the only levers that you have. Either the employees pay more, or they're healthier and your claim costs go down.
I just think we would be better off not to wait to do everything at one time.
Sure.
It needs to be a gradual, as we can make it.
Yes, strategically, you know, we're looking at 2015 right now.
Correct.
Okay. We may not know, you know, how everything's going until the last minute, and then there, those changes may be extremely drastic hitting to employees, and, you know, you can... always adjust different things, but you know that is a strategic consideration.
Well, and a lot of your major considerations are on this list, or on this huge poster. So you're looking at what is it that we do, and what is it that all everyone else across the board does. I'm not going to go line by line, and I'm not thinking that at bedtime you're going to do this, but it's always a possibility to look at what your competitors or what the comparative organizations are doing, and some of them have plans that are. You're just as rich as far as what their employees are paying. But this is going to affect everybody. I mean, the Cadillac tax isn't something levied on just the counties or, I mean, it's affecting everybody. It's not even officially, I mean, we know what's supposed to happen, but they still don't have all of the rules fully written about it, and it probably won't be.
But that is
years
not
to come,
a lot
but
of
you
employers.
Would want to think about making changes, if you're going to gradually make changes, and again, one is either keep your claims cost low, but your claims are running great right now. All things equal, you know, your Cadillac tax on that we're predicting here gets pushed off for years because you're $1 million lower than we predicted you would. Again, it's all predictions, and we can't do anything but use current data to keep predicting out forwards.
But, you know, that's one thing we could use for our employees is preach the wellness program to help keep premiums down.
Absolutely.
Say, you know, if you don't want your taxes to go up, you've got to keep our claims at a minimum, and you've got to be in shape. I mean, it's just, you've got to start being in the wellness program.
And you have wellness initiatives.
Our wellness program is wellness really kindergarten level. Yes, wellness life.
Go by and get a blood pressure check. You know,
there's companies that basically require that you have set standards met with all different kind of criteria. You have coaches, you have, you know, quarterly types of medical staff visiting. I mean, they really get into it and they tie into your premiums and I mean ours is overall a very light, non-invasive type of plan.
So I'm sorry.
But if you talk about either going up on the spousal coverage or removing spouses altogether, that's a pretty major plan for a lot of our employees.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
It's part of the attraction of keeping them here. You know, once the economy improves, we find people trying to hire our staff. Thinking and just arbitrarily pay them more money, whereas, you know, a benefit package is going to make it some of them there. You know, we just can't get, we're not on a bonus program for people here,
right.
Where they have a percentage of the bottom line like they can be into a private industry.
And you can see across
Again, the last.
I'm with you, it needs to be gradually phased in.
Gradually, run all at one time.
If it has to happen, but we need to realize, recognize what a.
You said right now it's 25 a month for spouses?
25, a pay period, so that's $650 a year is the easiest way to look at it. $650 a year.
So what I was trying to do is paint a big picture for you. One, your costs are low, as far as cost share for your employees, right? As far as the premiums they pay. I'm definitely recommending not to raise those again in light of how good things have been with claims money.
Right.
Right? As well as we've done, I don't even know if you can going out the bid and getting bids that came back that are the same or lower than you currently have, being able to shift more costs to employees this year, I would. There's grounds to always do it because you're cheaper than everybody else, but I'm saying I'm not recommending a change to employee contributions this year. But I would recommend a change to the out-of-pocket maximum to help account for some of the mandates. You want to talk about moving gradual, it's a very small step, but it's one step towards your Cadillac tax liability. Exactly your point is with that. Yes, that mitigates a little bit of it. That's how you do it, a little bit slowly pushing expenses. And again, the people that are going to feel that are going to be the people that are heavy users. But, and again, the people that it can benefit others too. Someone on a, specifically somebody on a high medication usage or a very expensive one will actually benefit in the long run from this. They may pay a little bit more, but it's going to stop. I mean, they're not going to pay anymore. Again, that doesn't affect a lot of the population, but it does affect some of the population.
So basically, the only thing you suggested with you now is like a single go to 35, 15, 73. Is that right, Dave?
I'm sorry.
I am, yes, 35, 7, 15, and 3.
Good, that's what you're suggesting we do right now.
I am.
And not go up on the spouse.
On the singles, 500 each on the core and the bottom.
No, that might be part of it.
35.
Okay.
So from 1,000 to 35?
No, 35.
Just the first column.
Adding 500,
Okay.
1,000.
So it would go up on the spouse.
3,500.
Yeah.
You begin, those that use it begin to look at the, really compare. And at some point,
And leave the out-of-network?
A point where they, if they are, they'll go with it.
You're at the high end of the out-of-network, except for one at Barra, you're higher than.
Long time.
Okay.
Most people aren't going out-of-network anyway. If someone's out-of-network, $6,000 or $12,000, they're already getting it hard enough that I don't see that we need to change that, but.
Daniel, can I ask a question? I know you've got one on the back here.
Well, that's because we're out of room.
Tobacco versus non-tobacco. And you can see the difference in the premiums for tobacco versus non-tobacco. Any, in the industry, is there any indication that increasing the out-of-pocket, not out-of-pocket, the.
Surcharge.
Yeah, surcharge, if you will, for tobacco users? Are we where we need to be with respect to that surcharge? Or have you had a chance to look at that?
I don't know. I didn't compare industry standard on what your surcharge is.
Because the difference, let's say.
Our tobacco surcharge, $650?
Mm-hmm, okay.
$650 a year?
It's not written on.
Yeah, it just shows the different rates, if you will.
Yeah.
So it's $650 a year?
And again, that goes back to the honesty factor too.
Yeah.
Yes.
The $197 on the spousal and the numbers for tobacco is.
So it's $650 a year for.
I'm sorry you have to flip, but it's the only way I could get it on point.
It's okay.
And we currently only have it for employee tobacco users. We do not have it for dependents, which Affordable Care Act says you can provide that.
You can provide that, but again, you probably do know this, but just to mention, if you have a tobacco surcharge like this, you also have to have a wellness initiative. You also have to offer the smoking cessation plan.
Which we do.
And we do.
No, I know you do.
We addressed that last, yeah.
And we actually have people enrolled in it now, not only in one medication, but also a specific plan.
But if they, correct me if I'm wrong, if they enroll in it, then They're not charged the surcharge.
Once they complete the enrollment, yes, that's correct.
But I think there's a loophole or two in there as well as.
Yeah, and we have to refund them.
You can go through the plan, have your rates reduced, start smoking if they do.
Whatever.
Yeah, or whatever. They can simply sign up for the plan again the following year, right? And then it's waived.
Well, if they've gone back to tobacco use, they have to indicate in back in open enrollment that they are a tobacco user then, and go back onto the re-enroll in the plan again each year.
So you could go through the plan January 1st through the smoking cessation January 1st. Mm-hmm. Go back smoking again.
For tobacco use.
Tobacco
again.
Use again.
Yeah.
Acknowledge that. The rates for the entire year are backed out, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then January 1st, they can go through the smoking cessation plan again, and the rates back off, then start smoking again.
And
is
the county pays
fair?
For that full plan,
yes.
For that full tobacco cessation plan.
Mm-hmm. But if they're what?
If they're vaping, it doesn't count.
I'm sorry.
Full Dave set. Just wants to say
I didn't know if the full
just,
committee did that.
So going back, Doug and I were talking amongst ourselves on the upping the spouse. Would it be better to go ahead and do an incremental upping of that in hopes maybe by the time this Cadillac thing rolls around that some of those will opt to do their own insurance rather than the county's, or is that?
I don't know what the pain threshold is for a family member to force them back onto their plan because they're making a comparison between what that spouse's plan is, how good it is.
And yeah, these are not people without insurance. They're people with dual insurance for both.
Yeah, but if you pay $650 or more for your wife, their insurance must not be that good.
Must be pretty bad, but where is that point?
Well, it's
still
the premiums.
Well, but look at your family cost share. And it's 8% and 16%. I mean, they're
nobody
making
has
up the ground.
They're
making up the ground
to get on the other one.
Yeah. Right. They would
and
be losing
on the benefits.
And they charge, a lot of the other employers charge a lot more
correct.
To have your spouse add.
Especially independent coverage. Yeah, it could be 50% of the cost.
Oh,
yeah.
Really?
Yeah,
yes.
Very high.
Very high.
So what would be fair? What is a, I mean, ours is
competitive.
Yeah, what would be competitive? What would be a,
as
I'm just trying to think of something that will get us.
Well, I mean, if you look at,
yeah.
If you look at your monster spreadsheet again, you can see what family coverages are forcing their employees to pay, and you can see where yours sits. You're on your core plan, your family is paying 8% of the total cost. Other plans are paying a minimum of 20. I mean, if you started raising premiums on family plans, that starts to drive them away. It doesn't always have to be the surcharge. It can be the cost itself.
Yeah.
So if you want people to not be on your family plan, then you start charging them 20% or 30%.
Well,
the surcharge, yeah.
What they can do then, though, is enroll in employee and children then. They don't
true.
Have a family. I didn't want it to be
right.
perceived that then there's no family coverage. That's not true.
True.
Okay.
You
they still
have
the option
levels.
Of employee and spouse, employee and children. The family is basically a combination of spouse and children.
True.
And that's very low.
I mean, personally, I don't like charging anybody a dime more than what you have to, but I don't want to wait and then all of a sudden, because of the government, federal government, because of that Cadillac tax, then be shocked with this huge something. You know,
so
I'd rather it be gradual
something.
And not,
yeah.
I'd rather prepare.
Yeah.
Well, when you,
yeah.
when you make the employees pay more in premiums, that is lowering the county's liability. So ultimately, that is affecting the Cadillac tax too. Premiums for you, since you're self-insured, come off your bottom line. Premiums in a fully insured world, like your car insurance, they by it going up for you, it doesn't. This directly affects
right.
the county's liability. So if you were to raise premiums on any line of coverage, you know whether you wanted, again, whether you wanted to push employees or employee plus spouse, because you have employee only, employee plus child, employee plus spouse, and family. So you should have four tiers.
Right.
If you were to raise your tiers, the cost for employee plus spouse, or even the family coverage, higher, you can drive your population a certain direction by pulling that lever, and the lever is make that more expensive, make them pay not just a surcharge, but a higher premium too.
Let me ask you, now it says we've got 197 employees with spouses premium. Are they in a family plan, or just, they just pay an extra for the spouse? I mean,
it could be either, right?
It could be either one.
Yeah.
It just, they pay extra. Have
because
the
those, like I said, those are ones who are honest and have said that to the comptroller.
That their employee, that their spouses have additional coverage available elsewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. I do apologize, but I do have a 4 o'clock I have to run to. Okay. But Cheryl, I'm leaving you all
so
the
what do we need to make a recommendation on that component today, or what?
If there's a component that's going to affect our surcharge rate, any rate change, we would like to have that direction from you today.
But
just getting through all that.
But even charging me, but we still got. I mean, this would be 2015, correct?
Mm-hmm. This would be correct. Next year's rate,
yeah,
starting January 1 of next year.
We've really got 3 more years to look at it. I mean, well, I think we need to give the family or spousal some time to say, "Let you know, we're going to go up on you, or unless something changes." I mean, if we just go up now, I mean, it may be a shocker to them. I just think we need to tell them we're going to go up. I mean, go ahead and go up on the deductible. I mean, the other stuff we talked about, but just warn them that next year we are going to go up.
I'm just giving you the information so you can come to these conclusions. This is exactly what you should be thinking about. You have to think of this in a big picture sense.
Mm-hmm.
You don't necessarily have to change co-pays and all the everything else.
Well,
you
and
can
instead
directly
of going up,
figure
we
out.
Can do the, I mean, what he just said, instead of going up for them paying the co-pay, you can go up with your deductible.
I think raise the out-of-pocket max. It's a minor step.
Yeah,
We already voted, didn't we? No, we haven't voted for that. We just talked about it.
Okay.
I think we ought to do that.
Yeah.
But just start educating our employees that come 16, we ought to get some, put together some figures to give them that this, it could be this, this, and this.
Spousal
things.
So yeah, you can either continue to raise your spousal surcharge,
mm-hmm,
or raise spousal and family.
But in the scope of things, if we raise it even $5, it's going to be less than $25,000 a year. It's not going to be that.
It would hurt more to raise your premiums than it would be to charge.
Right, and then you've touched every employee, where if you, the fairness is, yes, if you raise the special surcharge, but then I know from administering that 197 we have now is probably going to drop down to 175. I mean, people, like I said, they're just not going to be honest about it. We can have them sign an affidavit type form as part of their role.
Right.
We've done
so
that too.
This affects them, period, not just whether.
So you're saying the most fair way to do it or to get the greatest benefit would be to do the premiums?
Yes.
Right.
Because
so
that's they have to elect this.
That affects everybody, not just 197, right, being honest.
Correct.
Or the option that, and I know you may feel strong with the option of for those spouses that have other coverage available that they're removed from the plan. To me, that's the most fairest from, but I hear from the employee side of already now the 197 we have feel like that we're discriminating against them because we're asking them to charge extra money. And there are we have a lot of county employees whose spouses work for the county, so they don't have to pay that premium. I mean, we hear that all the time in the department. but I know that's a big move too, and that's maybe
right,
something we're looking at down the road.
Well,
and also, decision we're making today, to me, again, for 15, we're not going to see the ramifications of that probably until we're sitting around the
16
and 17,
yeah,
budget, because we don't have a full year of claims even next year. We're having the same conversation.
Looking at it, raising the surcharge, you're just affecting such a limited population. This is a definite.
And I think it's just going to
escalate. It's a definite piece. Yeah. You raise your premiums. You can see, you know, I know that there's
different. Do you do just the family premium, or do you do all the way across?
I mean, if you look at your wellness, you can look at, again, you have to, it's crazy because you have your non-tobacco user without wellness, you have your non-tobacco user with wellness, and you have your non-tobacco, your
active user with wellness, which is high in the average bracket. So you have multiple different tiers here. When you look at it all together, though, you can still see the family,
right.
The family premiums or cost share across all tiers is off. I would avoid targeting them. They're going to see the surcharges and continue to target against families. You raise the premiums, and they're going to go, well, why did our premiums go up? Well, claims costs went up. And that's all they have to know, is that claims costs went up, because they do, mm-hmm. right? So, again, if you want to...
Well, that's why I was saying that we need to really work with our employees and just start telling them, you know, this is the figure this year, but next year, 2016, we've got to pick one of these rates. We're going to, this is to educate you. This is going to go up.
And again, I don't think that we can continue to count on the fact that your claims are being managed so tightly that you're coming in the budget. Mm-hmm. That's an anomaly. I don't have any clients that normally do that. You're just luckily, it's happening here. And so we have time to sit around and have these kind of discussions because you're sitting in a great boat. Mm-hmm. Your claims aren't going up right this second. But they're
in that
going
valley
to. Yeah, they're going to go up at some point. And so you're going to have to make changes regardless of increasing somehow. Either the county has to take the brunt on of the increased claims costs, just how you're going to budget for it, or you're going to start making premiums go higher, or you're going to make copays go higher, you're going to make deductibles go higher to account for that. But it will happen. It's going to happen, and that will also affect your Cadillac tax at the same time. So it's claims.
I'm just saying that's what we need to. That's we've got a problem for that. We didn't educate our employees. They didn't, y'all just went up on us and didn't tell us. So if we do have time, like I said, we have time to sit here. We can adjust our out-of-pocket network right now to educate our employees next year that this is going to happen this year. Make plans for it.
If we do that, and I will tell you, Dave and I and Pat have talked about this for several years. If we do that, and what our goal obviously is to keep those premiums down, if there's a percentage that's more comparable to what others are paying, perhaps that's what our goal is, and it's just a matter of how do we get there. And when we can begin to educate the employees that our goal is to get more in line with what others' out-of-pocket payments are.
Sure.
And then how do we get there? During the next 3 to 5 years, this is how we're going to get there. So that would be the education piece of it. We have attempted to do that in the past, and we haven't gotten to that point. We thought about, we discussed a 3 and 5 year plan in the past, and just never got there. So this may be the time to really put that in place, mm-hmm. and begin to educate the employees about those increases.
I think you're right. We need a 3 year plan, a 3 year plan, saying if the finance of the Cadillac tax does come into effect, we've got to be prepared for it. This is going to happen in the next 3 years.
And would it hurt us in any way to put a little chart showing? You know, I mean, when you look at some of these, are charging 20-something% versus our 8.
Sure.
We're very much
in line with that in our presentations. The meetings this year are going to be mandatory. I'm getting almost scheduled. Mm-hmm. So all 200 employees are going to have to attend. It's not just going to be a word of mouth thing.
It does, again, it does make it harder because you can, as you flip over, depending on, you know, you can see the tobacco users are paying a higher percentage. That's your surcharge line, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
And then you can see here, tobacco users with wellness, non-tobacco users and the wellness discount. Look at, they're paying 6% as a single and 5% as a family of their total cost. And you're rewarding them for being healthy, and that's perfect. That's what we're wanting to do. But you also can see that, you know, the cost share is. I'm not trying to penalize employees. This is exactly what we're wanting to do. But you're encouraging them. Don't smoke. Get your wellness. Get a low premium. But you're taking that cost off. And a lot of other counties don't even have that option. They don't have wellness nor tobacco option. You just pay what you're going to pay, smoke or non-smoke.
Why did we do it that way?
I think didn't our insurance company come to us and want us to do a wellness program?
Yes.
I mean, it was their idea. Was it Aetna or was it the...
That was Cigna. Cigna.
And they have, Cigna has a huge wellness board part. They built this wellness initiative part. That's not uncommon. That's good. You're self-funded. You should have a heavy wellness. That's another thing that maybe, again,
you go towards raising your premiums a little bit, start making up some ground, and then I don't know what kind of loans, I don't have that right here to present to you, but maybe you get more aggressive on a loans plan. Maybe you give them certain metrics they have to meet, or there's another charge that's affected that. Because, again, a healthier population is lower claims costs. I can't give you an ROI on that. I can't sit here and say, hey, I can guarantee you every dollar you spend, $3 comes back. But it's hard. These aren't easy decisions. I can only tell you what others are doing and what you're doing. And, you know, we're doing the right things. The claims are going the other way, but I think that's, again, off of kind of Coventry and the way they're managing the claims. Because Cigna claims are way up here, and that's in here. They're way up here, and it's $1 million that you gain. And again, you can't count on that forever. So we're in a spot where we can.
So what was staff thinking? What were y'all thinking we should do? I mean, were y'all thinking just go with what we were talking about and just do these increases, or
well,
do you think we ought to do something? I mean,
that's the first time y'all seen these increases, isn't it? But today, the $500?
No, we've talked about it.
We talked about that. And I talked about that again. And here I talked about it before, but you wanted to see what other plans were looking like. That's why I put it together. So you could see it. That was an original recommendation was to at least at a minimum make that change.
What kind of decision do we have to make today? Is it time to set these rates?
Well, yeah, because you're going to bring it before the board for approval to start open enrollment
right.
And so on.
Mm-hmm.
So
we
got to
do that.
We got to make some decision.
I think answer the question. The staff committee, I don't think we took a position on changing the special surcharge. We don't have to take a position.
We did not.
We didn't rule it out, but we didn't take a position.
What about on premiums?
But we did say on. We didn't recommend raising premiums this year. Again, just costs were down. It'd be hard to justify that.
The costs are down. Nobody knows that except whoever's watching the video. And then basically your claims numbers are lower than projected. So the costs are, in theory, down.
But that's something that we ought to encourage our employees
to keep them down.
Y'all have done a great job this year. Our costs are down. And we're trying to, that helps us maintain the low cost of insurance.
So you give them a no cost premium increase.
Absolutely.
I mean, people,
yeah.
I don't know anybody that's not going to go, that's awesome.
Yeah. Well, that's why you reward.
Right.
But we did recommend changing the maximum out of pocket because of the change.
I'm not saying we're going to, highlight that.
What is that?
I mean, it's going to be.
Yeah, that's right. You're changing, yes.
Upping that $500
off. Right. Don't end up in below. Right here.
$500,000.
It goes from,
3,500,
and then it goes up to
7,000.
Yeah.
2,000.
And again, and for some people,
they
still win on this out of pocket. That is,
it's really going to not have much impact on
it's
people.
Not
it's
going
to counteract the effect of the law change. So that's all.
Correct.
Okay.
We're going to mitigate some of the law change by changing that one small thing.
That's all we were
doing. And sometimes, Danny, that's kind of a self-management thing tool as well.
Absolutely.
Maybe you go to the doctor every time you have a cold or a sniffle, and now
And that's a whole, you are absolutely correct. And again, that's part of the reason why some plans have moved, and I don't even want to get too deep into it, but that's what high deductible plans are all about. Mm-hmm. You raise the deductibles so that employees think before they have to jump in, do I really need to go do this, or do I need to do that? You don't have a high deductible plan. We don't want to talk about that, but those are the triggers and the new plans, other plans, are to get away from traditional and go towards something that forces employees to think longer and harder about going to the doctor.
Well, I would like to see us do our out-of-pocket network changing, like we talked about, but then also get on a 3-year health plan that we tell employees what's going on. Have some meetings with them. Like I said, get a 3-year plan. This is what's going to happen.
What could be coming?
This is what could be coming. We don't know, but we want to tell you, and you will know what's going to come. And there's nothing much we can do about it. And but as long as you help us praise them for telling the cost low, so y'all helping us keeping our cost low. I mean, it's no secret. Our claims are down. Y'all doing good. So, but I would like to see something done along those lines.
I'm good with that we need to do these, don't we?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Can I go back to one thing? You had mentioned earlier all the different plans we've got.
You even called out one that you said you didn't even understand why we have that. Was that the tobacco and wellness?
No, I was making a joke that you have a tobacco user that can get a wellness discount. And I thought, that's crazy.
Yeah, okay. Okay.
You have a wellness discount.
That was,
I was making a joke.
He was a healthy tobacco user.
Yeah, he's a healthy tobacco user.
Once.
You can't offer a wellness initiative like that and not give everyone an option to have it.
Yeah,
that's why you end up having a tobacco user that can get a wellness discount, because you can't offer it to one and not the other. That is it against the ACA. So,
but what I heard earlier is that, Cheryl, was there's a chance that some of these that are that spouses that are currently on the plan, that if we were to bump up that surcharge a little, there's a chance you're going to see some reduction in that?
There is. It's an honesty factor.
Yeah. Oh, she means that they won't report it.
They won't report it.
Not that they would migrate somewhere.
Oh.
Yeah, she's yeah.
They just want to admit that they've got another
but now, in that case, we would know who had it and who that now doesn't. So
this 197.
I guess there's a degree we
you
can investigate
that.
You
want to go to investigate. If you want to honestly put a surcharge, you don't cost them the surcharge, you raise the premium.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That hits everybody that has a spouse.
Okay.
Right. Period.
Well, like I said, it's
whether they have coverage or they don't,
it's kind of unfair to raise premium this year if we're doing so good.
It's true. It's not unfair. It means that you've run great. You're still paying $10 million a year in benefits. It's not that you're just, you can, again, you can see across the board that they're paying, especially in the family region, and I'm not saying target your families, I'm saying that you can see that your contribution strategy with families is 12 to 20 some odd percent below what others are. They're charging 20 and 30 percent of, they're charging 8.
That's why I said we need funding, look at a whole premium plan from single all the way to family and start to give us some options that this is what's going to happen.
I think you guys have done a great job. I don't disagree with the thought of telling them, hey, you've done great. Our claims, you know, we've really done well. I wouldn't tell them that you saved a million, but I would say that the claims have run great as a reward for this. We're given, you know, no increase in premiums. And you know what? If you come in next year, we'll know in advance. If you come in another $1 million under projected, perhaps there is something going on there.
But you got to be careful that you don't go overboard bragging on that from that end, because if you've got the Cadillac tax going to come up in 3 years anyway, you can set yourself up, well, you're still doing great, but sorry, we got to charge more because of Obamacare.
But in our projections, we were saying that your claims costs were going up 8% per year, and your claims costs haven't gone
down.
Obamacare
would be prolonged. I can't let that.
If you continue to run like you are, I mean, in a dream world, if you continue to run like you are, you can push the Cadillac tax off for quite some time.
Yeah,
so it will catch up. At some point, somewhere in the numbers, you will get caught by the Cadillac tax because your claims costs.
Meanwhile, we'll get the compensation study back, so that'll give us one more data point.
Right.
And then the last thing, maybe what this is the year to start, we talked about this before, staff, but if we can help the board get to some policies, and then the numbers end up with it. In other words, right now that our claims are down and we're not going to raise the premiums. Some policies would say, some employers, hey, if claims go up, there's a certain cost sharing percentage.
Right.
So the numbers end up with, and if the board passes a policy, you don't end up making this decision here. Mm-hmm. So if claims go up 20%, then maybe premiums go up 20%, that kind of thing.
You have a policy already in place.
That goes out 2 or 3 years. So we probably need to start working on that.
I bet a lot of people have
that. That would help the board. With
not
this
have to
decision
make the
point,
decision.
They've already made a decision by a policy.
That's very true.
It's
a very good strategy, and then it takes the onus off the board to constantly go, oh, we're going to raise tax, we're going to raise it. Mm-hmm. If you put it in place, it's just an even share.
Right.
It goes up, you go.
This is what's going to happen. So
because the policy will be communicated, well, that it is reasons for the policy, and then it's the numbers follow.
Do you need these back?
That's a good idea.
Is there a
you said framework.
Right.
Yeah.
What policy
you put that in
just to recommend to the board that we increase the out-of-pocket maximum to the numbers mentioned from either the page here, from
in-network
on the choice 1500 from 3,000 to 3,500 single, from 6,000 to 7,000 family,
And on the buy-up, we are the 500 plan from 1,000 to 1,500 for single and from 2,000 to 3,000 for family. That's the motion.
So moved. Second.
Second.
Third one. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. That is 4-0 with Commissioner Ham being absent at this point. Is there any other business to come before this committee?
Make a motion to adjourn.
So moved. Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. You are adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation.
You're welcome.
And thank you for doing the cost comparison. I asked for it, but I think it's helpful.
Yeah.
It was,
I asked for it. I did.
A lot of work, but if it gives you what you need.
Thank your assistant.
But don't you think that?
We know how it works.
But don't y'all think it's helpful?
I wish I had an assistant.
I mean, it was helpful to me.
No, absolutely. I'm glad
it'll be helpful
to put it together.
I think it's very helpful to the employees to see how would we know that ours was better than the different person's.
Oh, yes.
I'd say they know when they shop around with a different job. Because I know when candidates come here and I show them.
I have plenty for you.
Wow.
Oh, not that many. This is a fact. This one, always.
We're good? You want to lose one?
Thank you.
Yes, it's six.
Six, eight, ten.
Yeah, I can't, I got.
So we're saying everything sounds right.
Watch it.
Everything.
Oh, you can actually.
I'm good. Brian got all that?
You good?
Door.
Oh, it's a Thursday.
It's in, right?
One. I'll say one.
I just think we need to go with the surcharge. Just go to.
Thank you all. I know you worked on this as well. Appreciate your help, your assistance, Ryan. Thank you.
To like.
Because it'll get slated that I didn't show up.
You're lucky that things have been so good.
I can't wait to see Mr. Mack if any event is.
It's true.
I'll study
what you gave me. I haven't given you much yet, but just so I'm interested in everything correctly. I'll give you copies of what is covered. What I want you to see are the plans that are offered to address it. Again, there are choice select ones that are popular. They're the ones that came to me. And again, I didn't realize that had a whole map, whole vision specifically on that. The fact that you guys are on.
See you, sir. Good presentation.
Thank you very much.
Our play.
That's okay. Mm-hmm. I just want you guys to get the information so you can make educated decisions. I mean, that's the hardest part. It's really, it's a lot. I do it for a living. So to get you to the point, you're like, okay, I understand exactly what you're saying. This is what we need to do. That's important. That's my job.
Okay. Thank you.
I got to walk to the Baptist church.
I've got a question. Are girlfriends allowed on the plan?
Are girlfriends allowed on the plan?
Yes,
girlfriends
sir.
Are not allowed on the plan.
Okay, because Miss Angie Mullinex
as soon as you
gets
get married,
insurance
you can.
By the city of Cumming.
I have no idea.
And that's not hearsay. She said that under oath. And we asked her if she were an employee of the city of Cumming, and her answer was, what's an employee?
Yeah,
so
there.
As I get more information, we can continue to talk more about that. There are participation percentages that have to be attained in order.